Hello and welcome to Vintage Alternative. I'm Ryan Hamilton and I'm really excited to share this interview with Everclear frontman Art Alexakis. We, of course, all know songs like Santa Monica. Father of mine,
tell me where have you been? You know, I just closed my eyes, my whole world disappeared.
Wonderful.
Tell me everything is wonderful now.
Just to name a few. We talk about Everclear's success and longevity, but we also talk about some things you don't hear much about. Arts, bands, life, and musical career before Everclear. This is a really fun trip down memory lane and a fascinating glimpse into the life and mind of one of my all-time favorite songwriters and frontmen. Enjoy.
You're doing good now, buddy? You got a baby on the way?
Well, we just had a baby a little over a month ago. It's our first. Okay. And
That's exciting.
It is exciting and scary and wonderful, and I'm sure you know all of those things.
You're in the middle of the whirlwind right now, brother. Right? Yeah.
I am.
You're in a place in life where sleep is more important than sex.
It's so true. I didn't know.
You tell that to people, and they're like, "Nah, that's never going to happen." And then it's just no, like, okay, you're right.
Oh man, I thought it would be fun to do something different, if you don't mind. Of course, we'll talk about all the exciting current stuff happening with Everclear. But first, okay. if it's okay with you, I'd like to kind of do a backwards version of show and tell, where I show you a few items from your musical past, and all right. we just kind of see where it takes us, if that's okay.
Okay, that's fine.
All right, let's see what happens here. Okay, 1989. An album called Tragic Songs of Life from a band called The Easy Hoes with a guy on the back we might recognize here, I believe. What can you tell me about this band and this album from 1989?
Okay, well, first of all, hold the picture up of me. Hold that up. Get that in closer. That's the dark hair. If you look at me, my face, that was the year. That was about 3 weeks before I got sober.
Really?
That was 3 weeks before. You look at my face, you could tell.
Okay.
That was about 3 weeks before I got sober. I was so hungover for that photo shoot. I set it up and I barely remember it. You know, I was a blackout drunk at the time.
Oh my God.
But that was an album put, that was the first album put out on my own label called Shindig Records.
Okay.
And there was a really cool alternative country scene. It wasn't cowpunk. It was alternative country in San Francisco. And it was a lot of hipster-like people who would come from a punk rock and roll background, but were playing old school, like almost gospel-type country, but with a rock and roll feel to it and a rock and roll lyrical attitude to it. And that Easy Hoes record is really cool. That's me producing that. That's the first thing I produce ever as a producer. And it came out really cool. We recorded it in like 3 days, 4 days.
I love the album. It's, you know, when I first fell in love with Everclear, I did what a lot of music nerds do. I went back. You want to know.
The deep dive.
You know what I mean? You want to do it. And speaking of a deep dive, let's jump to 1990. Deep in the Heart of the Beast in the Sun by a band called Colorfinger. And when you see this, what comes to mind and what can you share about this album?
Well, that record, I consider, it came out in late 90. It really was like a hit in 91.
Okay.
But we made it in 90. At the end of the Easy Hoes first tour, which ended in like, you know, we had a female bass player and me and the other guitar player were both having affairs with her while we were both married.
Oh.
That wasn't going to work. That wasn't going to last very long. that ended in disaster, but I'm glad because I was glad at the time because I wanted to move the band into a harder, more harder rock, more rock. What people were going to call alternative, they really hadn't come out with that yet. And, you know, Nirvana hadn't hit yet. And so Colorfinger, that album was my first album that I wrote and sang and played guitar that was my band. And I used some friends to make it. And most of those guys became the band, but it started as a project, really. And I remember listening to it for the first time when it was finished later that year in like the fall of 1990 and listening to my little Sony Walkman, the cassette Walkman.
Yeah.
And it just like, wow, it was a big, big deal. It's a lot more rock than the Easy Hoes. A lot more punkish attitudes to it. But at the same time, there's a little bit of that country feel because we're still part of that scene that was evolving in San Francisco at the time.
Speaking of that scene, perfect segue. Thank you for this perfect segue that's happening right now. I want to talk about this amazing.
Oh, no way. You got Lazy Loud Liquored Up?
The title.
How much did you pay for that?
You know, I was a touring musician for a long time, and I just am a huge music nerd. I want to know it all. So I looked in record stores. I had a list. I would carry a list with me. So,
oh, wow.
I know this is probably worth a lot of money to some people, but I think I bought it for maybe $10, you know,
wow,
back in the day. Awesome. But you mentioned your record label, Shindig Records, and people should know this features both of your bands from then, Colorfinger and the Easy Hoes. And this scene, you know, as a guy from Texas, I was such a fan of what was going on, you know, when this was happening. When you see this, what comes to mind? Do you remember figuring out what bands, you know, were you going to put on it?
Well, yeah. Well, when I started the label, it was originally a vehicle for the Easy Hoes. But at the same time, I wanted to document the scene. I wanted it to become more of a cohesive scene that people knew about, and people were writing about it in local press. And so I went out, met this gal, Cammie, who was a DJ, and she had an alternative radio show on a local college station. And she played a lot of these bands, their demos and their records. And through her, I contacted the bands and got them to record a song with me. Some gave me songs already recorded, most of them I produced. And we put it together on that record. And I am so proud of that record. And the album cover, I forgot the guy who did the album cover, but he had the idea for it. He was a photographer. And it just came out so cool. Just the
it's
layout,
fantastic. Yeah.
The burning, that's a real burning, that's not special effects. If we set like, he burned like two or three hats to get that look.
I have a very similar hat just back here. I don't know if you can see, but but yeah, I of course love this album art.
You know what, another thing about that album too is the first time I'd ever worked, it was before Pro Tools, was Pro Tools. It was called Sound Tools.
Okay.
It's an early precursor of it. And that's when we would take those little pieces of like, you know, like country people talking from old country radio and just stuff that we did a deep dive into, and we put it all together on there. And I remember how it sounded because it was the first CD we made because the Easy Hoses was vinyl only, not even cassette. And that was the next release, was Lazy Loud and Liquored Up. And I just remember listening to it, just going, wow. The possibilities of just overlaying sound and different effects and stuff like that and making
it really cool,
really sound thematic like that was really cool. Hey, I'll tell you something that I think you'll like. So last January of 2022, 19, so he's that old. 20, I'm grandpa.
Come on
2022. I found all my old tapes, including the original master tapes for that album, all those albums. And I've had them remastered from the original tape. And
did you have to bake them?
We had to bake them and clean them. I had to pay a guy who that's all he does. And it wasn't cheap. And it was a lot of tapes. But they're all on like two big old digital hard disks now.
So the internet, and the reason I know this date is because it's my birthday. The internet officially launched as the World Wide Web on April 30th, 1993. And it would be several more years before people were using email, and even longer before it was possible to upload or send a digital music file. So I think it would be interesting if you shared, you know, how did it work in the 90s for the kids? Before the internet, if you wanted to send a record label your demo or share your music with the radio station, what went into that? You can't just send an email.
Well, that's interesting. I got a story on that one. So when we made World of Noise, or Everclear's first album, was living in Portland. We were poor. I had a baby, new baby at home. And I got a chance to record that record for $400 worth of trade. I had a couple of, like I had a digital delay and a quad reverb, a digital reverb, and I traded it to this guy for $400 worth of recording. $10 an hour, 40 hours. God. And we recorded the whole album in a couple of weeks, mixed it. And before I sent one tape out and a bio to South by Southwest immediately because I just made the deadline. And they wrote me back, actually called me and said, look, it was late getting here, but we love it. We got you on two showcases. Can you make it March, blah, blah, blah? And I'm like, I'll be there. And I used my old connections from Color Fingers, and we booked a tour of clubs all the way from Portland to Austin, Texas, and to play it. But before we left, I got all the money I had in the world, made cassette tapes of World of Noise, did a bio for it with pictures, put them in like envelopes, and mailed them to every club, every venue, every paper that writes, there was no blogs at the time, there was no podcast. And so that's why you did it. You mailed them out. So we mailed all those out. As we were leaving town, we stopped at the post office and I put them all in. We split and we headed to Austin. And coming back, this is before cell phones. I just had a pager, right? And my girlfriend, you know, soon to become my second wife, mother of my oldest daughter, called me and was like, you know, like, you need to call home. And I called home. She goes, you need to get home right now. There are 66 messages on our phone machine.
Amazing.
People want to talk about your album. What album? I go, they're talking about the tape. Jenny, come on. I go, really? Wow. And people just freaked out on it. And we started getting gigs we couldn't get before. We started opening for nationals. And we did a tour later in the year. In 93, and we got labels and publishing companies coming after us, and finally in 94 we got a publishing deal and we signed with Capitol, and that's where it all started. And we went that summer of 94 went and made Sparkling Fade at Smut Studios.
Isn't he just the best? If you enjoyed this chat, please subscribe to the channel here and check out our new podcast. It's called Undiscovered and Recovered, where we listen back to some previously unheard demo cassettes from the 90s. It's super fun. This is Vintage Alternative. I'm Ryan Hamilton. Thanks for watching.
Downtime. I don't wanna be your stupid game. With my big black boots and an old suitcase, I do believe I'll find myself a new